four players are gathered around a table. Between them, a kind of still life of coins from various countries, broken candles, a knife, wine in a chalice, a lute, tool of the trade, and a stack of cards. When the Tarot de Paris was printed, most used it simply for gambling, an instrument to kill time and win money. But already then, 400 years ago, the pictures on these cards had some mystical symbolism attached to them, like a mirror to the lives of its players. And so the game these four musicians around the table are participating in has them taking turns, each drawing a card from the tarot and then matching it with a piece of music. And that's what the lute is for. This piece was written by Michelagnolo Galilei, younger brother to the famous astronomer Galileo. Far beyond Florence and Italy, their father Vincenzo had already made a name for himself as lutenist and music scholar. Following in his footsteps, Michelagnolo is taught music from an early age, but when his father suddenly dies, the 14-year-old has difficulty finding work as a musician in Florence. It's his older brother's international connections that finally help him land the position far from home, in the Polish city of Krakow. After 13 years playing for the local nobility, he eventually receives an offer to instead work for Maximilian, Duke of Bavaria, apparently again thanks to the influence of his famous brother. In a letter, Maximilian thanks Galileo for the revolutionary telescope he had sent from Florence, and just a bit later there's also a message from Michelagnolo. Thank you again for the telescope that you sent me, for which the most esteemed Duke gave me 100 silver coins, which helped me out quite a bit. From Munich, your most affectionate brother. Even with Galileo's help, Michelagnolo's salary in Munich was barely enough to scrape by. Only after several years does he manage to save enough money for financing the printing of his first book, which turned out to also be his last. Dearest and most honored brother, I believe I will resolve to publish the book here, since I find many difficulties in coming to Florence now. The money has been spent, so it's necessary to proceed with this, and if only to make known to the world that I'm capable of a little something. The same year that Galileo's trial against the Roman Inquisition took place, the Pope's personal, private musician was the lutenist Johannes Kapsperger. His Toccata Quinta, you're hearing it right now, was written sometime after his arrival in Rome, where he soon became known as Il Nobile Alemano, the German noble, a persona of his own making, as Giovanni Girolamo Kapsperger had actually been born in Venice, though into the family of an Austrian colonel. His choice not to follow in his father's prestigious footsteps in favor of music is lauded in this poem prefacing his first book. Knows to strike the lance as thou writest song, to weapons sounding the muses sing on, and on the cover of both Apollo's instruments and the Martian arsenal. A symbolical image he leaves behind when his employer turns pope, and he in turn his lutenist. Eventually, Kapsperger's songs also find their way into the hands of Marin Mersenne, still at work on his Harmonie Universelle, a major musical encyclopedia. Having arrived in Rome, I wish to send you the entire book of odes of our Holy Father, who is a great admirer of intellectuals and good musicians, set to music by that author of whom I did speak to you in Paris. Like Marin Mersenne in France, the German scholar Athanasius Kircher was driven by the ambition of mastering and compiling all of the available knowledge in the various scientific disciplines, and his big book on music often also features the work of Kapsperger as composer, apparently a friend of his. With his great mind and the help of other sciences, in which he is an expert, he succeeded in penetrating the arcane mysteries of music. In that spirit, this brand new piece experiments with Kapsperger's most famous work, a sequence of harmonies, each with this arpeggio sign, telling us to break up the chord like this. So the lowest string goes first, and that pattern is played four times before proceeding to the next harmony, and so on until the end of the piece. Now, one of the concepts Athanasius Kircher writes about in his Arithmologia, a book on mathematics, is the magic square, a grid of numbers that add up to the same sum in each direction, like a Sudoku. So with our 4x4 note pattern, there's exactly 48 combinations to achieve this, and Kapsperger's piece just happens to have 48 harmonies. Well, more or less. So what if we tried assigning to each chord one permutation of this magic square? Illustrious and learned Galileo Galilei, foremost philosopher of His Highness in Florence. Just now I received your letter, having visited Mr. Ciampoli yesterday to discuss what you asked, and we agree that your nephew might best be accommodated in the house of a certain Giovanni Girolamo Kapsperger, excellent musician and man of honor, who holds a musical academy where the boy should have occasion to study. This letter from Rome about Galileo's nephew regards his brother Michelagnolo's teenage son, for whose specialized education several different options are being considered. From Paris, I received a letter by Sir Renato, who offers to instruct my son precisely in what he knows, telling me the boy already plays differently from how he did back in Italy. This colleague Michelagnolo is talking about might have been the French lutenist René Mézangeau, one of the most influential of his generation. The sound that he helped develop is in fact part of what makes Galilei's music so different from that of Kapsperger, for example. And with successive generations of French lutenists, it's turned into a completely unique style and culture, exemplified in this piece a student of Mézangeau dedicated to his teacher's memory, a kind of tombstone in music. After the burial of Mézangeau, another master and innovator of the French style died at the age of 59. But as far as we know, a tombeau for Nicolas Vallet was never written. Until now. The final entry in Nicolas Vallet's book is this elaborate setting of the Lord's Prayer, but in Dutch. Like many other Protestants, Vallet had to leave France and found refuge in the thriving metropolis of Amsterdam, a place welcoming to all those who were being ostracized or brutally persecuted in their homeland. As part of the Huguenot community of Amsterdam, Vallet was able to begin a new life and make a name for himself as lutenist and composer. And the foundation for his setting of the Dutch Lord's Prayer is taken directly from Martin Luther's original melody to Unser Vater im Himmelreich. Same melody that Vallet's fictional student would later base his Tombeau de Vallet, except now in the modern French style of the generations that followed. Mm-hmm. much as the elegance of Vallet's innovative style might have inspired lutenists who came after, he himself, of course, also took inspiration from elsewhere. In particular, the music of an English composer 20 years his senior, John Dowland, whom he probably never met in person but knew from his songs, printed and sold in Amsterdam's bookshops, some of which Vallet explicitly quotes and remixes in his own way. As with many of John Dowland's songs, there's multiple layers of secret references, double or even triple meanings hidden in the original basis for the Earl of Essex Galliard. With its exact counterpart, Can't She Excuse, Dowland alludes to the widely publicized affair between England's Queen Elizabeth and her much younger lover Robert, the actual Earl of Essex. Frustrated by her ambiguity, he eventually staged a coup, failed and was executed for treason. But much rather than the political scandal behind the story, it's the symbolical content that keeps the song relevant. To feel unfairly treated by Elizabeth was also John Dowland's autobiographical stake in Can She Excuse My Wrongs, as this letter explains in his own handwriting. 15 years since, I was in France, servant to the ambassador for the Queen's Majesty, and stayed in Paris, where I fell acquainted with one Mr. Smith, a priest, saying that Catholicism was the truth and ours in England all false, and I, being young, believed with them. 2 years after, I came into England, where I saw men of that faction condemned and executed, which I thought was great injustice, taking religion for the only cause. Then, time passing, one Mr. Johnson died, and I became humble suitor for his place, thinking myself most worthiest, but I saw that any might have been appointed but I, whereby I began to examine the cause, and guessed that my religion was my hindrance. My mind being troubled, I desired to get beyond the seas, which I dared not attempt without license, for fear of extreme punishment. Whereupon I spoke to your honor, my Lord of Essex, and you willingly gave me both your signatures.
When I did love, we thought it was very sweet.
The year when William Shakespeare wrote Hamlet, the tragedy about a Danish prince, John Dowland was already in Copenhagen, working for the King of Denmark, who wasn't a Catholic either, but also didn't really see a problem there.
How long will a man lie in the earth ere he rot?
Ye faith, if he be not rotten before he die, he will last some 8 year, 9 year.
10 years earlier, the legendary Richard Tarleton had died, England's most famous comedian and jester at the court of Queen Elizabeth.
Horse and mad fellas it was. Who do you think it was?
I don't know.
This same skull, sir, was Yorick's skull, the king's jester.
Of all the cards in the tarot, the jester or fool is the only trump to survive into our modern game of cards, where we now know it as the Joker. But apart from these mystical pictures, the Tarot de Paris is also made up of regular cards, divided into four suits: the coins, clubs, swords, and cups. So the four lutenists who are gathered around our table decide to play a new game now. For each card, a new take on something they've written in the past. Thank you. What you just saw was really just a short introduction to what I've been working on since the pandemic started. And as of today, Tarot de Paris is finally available to order. The 90-something publishers I proposed it to all rejected the book and the CD. So the only place you'll find it is my website. Not Amazon, not in stores, it won't be in magazines or on the radio. But on a more positive note, shipping is free. And I'm just really glad I can finally offer this to you. What really kept me going through all the setbacks was my belief in the stories told in this book and in the music it comes with, that someone out there would appreciate them. And if you do, please also tell your friends about it. There's no advertising for this, so if you think people should hear about it, it's all up to you.